And I'm happy to introduce our guest speaker, Professor Svandyar Masumi, who is the Distinguished Professor of Economics and Econometrics at Emory University, Atlanta. Professor Masumi is the author and co-author of more than 100 articles, and he is also the editor of Journal of Econometric Review. We are all very pleased to have Svandyar today here. Please give him a warm welcome as he comes to the stage.
Salam, salam. دیروز دو این از من خواست بهش یاد بدم یه چند تا لغت فارسی یه سلام رو یادش دادم یه خوبید and he did well he did well in many ways. اگه اجازه بدید چون که سواد فارسیم خیلی نرم کشیده به خصوص در کارهای فنی به انگلیسی صحبت کنیم چون ممکنه فکر کنم دوستای انگلیسیمون هم هنوز هستن نیست؟ اون به انگلیسی میگم هر موقع که تونستم یه چیزایی ترجمه میکنم سوال اگه خواستید به فارسی یا انگلیسی بکنید فرق نمیکنه اکثر اوقات میفهمم که چی میگید ولی خوب نمیتونم توضیح بدم خودم باعث افتخار منه که اینجا هستم و یه سعادتی برای من این اولین باریست که یک آدینس هموطن در شهر خودم مواجه هستم که شریک بشم با اتون یه مقدار افکاری یه مقدار کارهایی که کردیم و بهتر سویچ کنم otherwise I will get confused این the theme for this conference is a superb choice it's very important to be doing research that touches on the frontier because you do the effort whatever you work on if the topics that you hear and you encounter are hot or what everyone is looking at the frontier you have greater chance of communicating networking publishing and being part of the global education, global economy. And this topic of big data is really huge. Like all new topics, an old geezer, old guy like me, thinks that it was all done before. Everything changes game. I speak very slowly and they all come closer and closer. بهر تقدیر. اول سوالی که پیش میاد What is big data? What is big data? عرض کنم که سه تا کاتگوری مختلف میشه گفت What is big data? Okay, so what does big data mean? It could mean that we are observing a lot more data, a lot more variables. We observe more things than we ever did before. از این نظر به نظر سوژه جدید میاد ولی براتون بگم من سال 1979 یک manuscript I saw a manuscript from the United Nations, Morris and Morris. It had 129 different indicators for something like 90 countries. Number of radios, the number of kilometers that were paved, access to medicine, income, health, education, 129 indicators, 1979. But no one knew about it. It's still news when I tell my colleagues. They were collecting that kind of data on so many indicators of well-being for so many different countries. So that's one way, big data. You go to a supermarket, everything you do is being recorded. Which aisles, which rows you go to is being recorded. What you buy, what you pick up to look at, whether you buy it or not, is being recorded. Zillions of data points on different indicators of your behavior is being recorded. That goes back to the early 80s. Again, not very popular. Part of it because computation has changed. We didn't have the computing capability. Now that we do, these things have resurfaced. I found out a couple of weeks ago, Jeff Wooldridge wrote me that Facebook regards him as very liberal. I didn't know that Facebook actually analyzes all your postings for your relatives and friends and actually comes up with an index of whether you're conservative or a liberal or a radical or whatever. Every time you're on Google, you go on Priceline or Kayak to find a hotel room. For the whole month, you're bombarded with ads about that city and the hotel rooms in that city and how about renting a car? How about taking flights? So all of this data by your clicks are being collected. So it's massive in terms of dimensions, indicators, new variables. So that's one way we could say we have big data. The other is look at the same variables of interest, especially in the cross-section, individual characteristics, household characteristics. We now have much larger samples, frequently observed samples from many different. So the number of observations is exploding. Number of variables exploding. Number of observations per variable is exploding. On the time series side is a little bit different. You can dream of observing annual GDP of a country as long as you want, but there's only so many years that are available, right? So data frequency is what is meant as big data in the time series. You have annual data, you have monthly data, weekly data, and you have blow-by-blow trading data. So the frequency is the only way, higher frequency is the only way you can have big data in the time series. I'm going to raise some flags, red flags, some hopeful things about big data and some words of warning about big data. So as you get more and more data, you get more and more information. Our DNA says, our instinct says, more information reduces uncertainty, increases knowledge. As early as the early 80s, I wrote a paper with von Furstenberg showing that entropy, a measure of uncertainty, is kind of a flatness of a distribution, increases certainly with dimension. So the more dimensions you observe, the greater the entropy, the greater uncertainty. You're getting more information, but you're less certain. And with greater frequency. So if I actually had an information revolution in those days, we were expecting it to happen. Chris Sims was invited to discuss the paper. He got up. His main point was, what information revolution? He didn't even believe it was coming. But the point is, information is a much deeper concept than having more variables and more observations. In my free time, I'm an information IT guy, information theory guy. I look at the distribution of things and analyze the distribution of things by their entropies and other characteristics to squeeze out the information that they have. Then it's a question of what do you want to do with the increased information with the data? There are two or three directions we can go. One is that you want to have all these indicators, back to the example of many, many variables. You want to find singular scores to identify people by their many dimensions. You have health, you have education, you have income, you have other characteristics. I want to score you as an individual in terms of your well-being in all these dimensions, but my score is in scalar. So I have an indexing problem. the most classic of economics problems is indexing, hasn't been solved. More and more information doesn't mean your index is going to be richer. Not all indices are created equal. It would be part of what I will talk about. Some indices, some of the most dominant indices that we use, knowingly or unknowingly, are blind to the information in the data. I'll give you an example or two of that kind of thing, so that you're sometimes aware. If you run a regression, for instance, the workhorse of social sciences and other sciences, you're not really capable of learning a lot of the information in data. Regression can suss out only certain types of information. Use a particular index number. It has a certain functional form, like Gini, the most dominant income inequality index, is utterly blind to the tails of the distribution. It just doesn't see it. Year after year, people report it, and it's the same number, 0.42, 0.43. Old policies, all the changes, it can't see it. All the changes are in the tail. Someone wants to alleviate poverty. Gini can't see it. It's just the most dominant income inequality index. It's an index, it's a scalar function of a distribution, all of the information in a distribution. So what your index can do can determine whether you are capable of seeing the information in the data or not. With more and more variables and observations, so one purpose would be not so much discovery of the mechanisms of laws in economics or finance or other fields, but just fitting. You want to predict well. Believe it or not, that's an indexing problem. So I have all these variables, all the observations. I want all of them to speak about one variable, investment, rate of interest, or consumption. That's an indexing problem. That's an aggregation problem. We put it in the jargon of the statistics. It looks different, but it's an indexing problem, as I hope to bring out. Believe it or not, that's the greatest success area in big data. How can you massage and massively use all of these data to fit, to speak about an outcome? I'll exemplify that. That's where lasso penalizing shrinkage estimators and all of that have really become big, have come back. That's the sense in which an old geezer like me thinks is all old stuff, because we used to do shrinkage and things like lasso and penalization in the 60s and the 70s. They've come back with different names. We are no longer statisticians, we're all data scientists as far as big data is concerned. So some new jargon, some old techniques, but some old techniques that have really come to the fore because of computational capability. We could think of these things, we couldn't do them, now we can. So let's, for the lack of a better term, call that example of prediction black box fitting. I just want to have a great fit of some output and speak about it. The next step is to do the traditional econometrics thing. We want to learn mechanisms. I'm only interested in the impact of education on your hourly wages, the Mincer equation. Right? But I can't really do that because education is an outcome that depends on a lot of other variables, your experience, your age, believe it or not, dad's income, all of that. And I have to control for those. I've had trouble all these years, I meaning us, running a proper regression between three variables. What's the functional form? What else do I control for? Now I have 150 variables and massive numbers of observations. How does that new big data impact my discovery goal? Finding laws, finding empirical laws or real economic laws. That's really challenging. I'll put that paradigm up. I was stolen a couple of pages from Victor's website because I can't type, or I can't type properly, so I'll go through that. And then there is an implicit challenge in all of that. If you have a lot of data, a lot of variables, and a lot of observations, you still haven't solved the issue of how to filter it. What is the model, right? If you have to have controls, you're not just interested in fitting. You actually want to have a model. What is the right model? That's all econometrics, all the stuff that hasn't been solved in econometrics. Model selection is an essential part of this and becomes even tougher when you have more variables and more data. That's where model averaging, shrinkage, ridge regression, lasso, and all of that comes. So I'll try to exemplify that maybe in the second part of my discussion. So I'm very poorly organized, as Ali knows well. I had not written up this talk, so I brought bits and pieces from different areas. Some of them will reveal my age to you. They're old papers, and I needed formulae from them. And I've thought of ways of usefully discussing them for you today. Okay. So I want to talk about latent objects. And in a way, said everything I've told you is about latent objects. The thing that I was going to use a black box for, things as sacrosanct as income, are latent objects. What is income? Do you mean permanent income? Do you mean all your capabilities to spend? Do you mean the thing that the government measures or the wages that you get paid? There are all sorts of meanings to just even the most famous, well-known economic measurements. What is income? It's a latent object. Worse than that is, what is well-being? So 200 years of measuring people's well-being and relative well-being by income inequality, right? Why just income? If I live in the US, income is everything. Income decides whether I have good health, whether I have access to lawyers, to justice, what housing I have, what education I get or my kid gets. Everything is with the dollars. If I live in Germany, my health is provided. I'm not going to get fired tomorrow morning with a pink slip. They can't just do that. Some security. So if you really want to talk about well-being, some people call it happiness. Angus Deaton just got the Nobel Prize doing happiness. Well-being has many dimensions. The biggest mind in this area when I was a student was Amartya Sen. So I decided to do econometrics, but I always felt guilty. I thought I should have worked with him. So 3 or 4 years into being an econometrician, I took a secret sabbatical. I started reading about social choice and welfare and well-being and inequality, and my CV went down. I wasn't publishing, but I was learning a lot. So I'll tell you a little bit about this multidimensional well-being measures that brings in a lot of indicators as my example of indexing. It's come back with a vengeance. Everyone now is concerned about well-being and inequality, but it wasn't so for 30 years. So we'll talk a little bit about that. And let's talk about it then. That's a latent object, right? Well-being. Well-known variables can be seen as latent variables, latent objects. And the final point I want to make is a model, the data generation process, is the ultimate goal of econometrics work, is a latent object. We will never discover the true process that generates all the socioeconomic outcomes. There are zillions of people making decisions in many sectors, demographic changes, climatic changes, all of that come to produce the economic outcomes that we observe. So the hope of generating, finding the data generation process is really wishful thinking. So that's a latent object. All our models, I will argue toward the end of the talk, are indicators, are partial maps of something that we will never completely discover. So how do you aggregate? Now models become data dimensions. how do you aggregate all these models to say something about the data generation process? It's still a partialist statement, but the model itself, the econometric model, becomes the latent object to deal with. I have an example of the latest work with that, with a chap called Gospodinov. Stunningly, that work uses my work in economics about aggregation and econometrics work. All these years, I hadn't seen the connection myself. So if I have a chance, there's time, I'll talk a little bit about that toward the end. Okay. There is always a concern, being an econometrician, both a cultural thing and in terms of publication, whatever you say, can you attach a probability to it? The ultimate claim to being scientist is being able to attach a probability to statements. Otherwise, we would be waving hands and just saying wise things, right? So inference is a big deal. And a lot of things that have happened with big data and new ways of doing model discovery, estimation, inference are challenged because the statistical theory about it is quite complicated. This afternoon, we have Victor, who's probably producing the best work in that area. So the inference, how do you make statistical statements? What is the distribution of the statements you make? Predictions, estimation, and so on. That area is ongoing. If you're looking for topics and you're mathematically inclined in doing statistics, that is totally open. There's very, very little known. Victor, I'm expecting, he will talk about new asymptotics, where P is larger than N. N is the number of observations. We are used to having that go to infinity. That's what asymptotic means. His asymptotics are about P going to infinity, number of variables. And it's pretty scary in terms of how to develop that theory, but more importantly, what does it mean? And I will leave him to do the young man's job. So let me talk about what I hope to present, a little bit about variable selection, sort of the black box thing. In that regard, I'll talk about penalization, shrinkage, ridge, lasso. I use the opportunity, because it's my first time in the country, to advertise mostly my own work. As you might imagine, it's a very small part of what is being done in all of these areas, but I'm the most familiar with it, so I'll talk about it. And then aggregation indexing, which I quickly talked about. There was a 1986 paper in which I produced these aggregators. I'll motivate them for you. Not much attention was paid to them, even though it was published in a good place. But now it is the index, basically, to use when you want to do multidimensional well-being. All the other indices become special cases of this index. So I hope to tell you about that. And this is where it gets tough. So, this is an old paper. It's not the 86 indexing. Can you read it? Is it legible? A little bigger? A bit better? I'll verbalize. As you can tell, I like to talk. So let's lay down the basics. I have a bunch of indicators. Variables, individuals indexed by I, the indicator dimension by F. So I have M indicators, education, health, income, let's say. Or these could be things you consume, different good categories. I have this matrix of N individuals in M indicators. It's a multidimensionality problem. How do I find an index, a singular scalar, to represent this matrix? So every individual will be characterized by their M characteristics. How do I do that best? So the index number problem. In this paper, I dealt with this as a problem of unknown functional forms. So I'm actually having observations on an outcome variable, like an output. The XIs are inputs, and I have observations on many firms or many households. The idea is, the question asked in this paper is, what is the best functional form for this relationship? In the 86 paper, it was cast somewhat differently. I have the same welfare matrix, and the idea is, what is the best index of well-being for these individuals? There's a huge difference between the two concepts, the two contexts. In this context, what is the best functional form? I have an output variable observed. I have a YI, as it were. For each individual, I observe some output variable, and I'm capable of running regressions. So this is a regression context. I'm just looking for the best functional form. In some sense, I will define what best is in my way of thinking. In the well-being context, there is no output to observe. You don't observe well-being. You want to construct it. So I have no means of running a regression. Is that clear? So the problem is the same. How do I combine these M variables on which I have N observations? In one context, I have a regression type context because I observe an output and I can run a regression to find the coefficients of this functional form. In the well-being case, I have no means of running a regression. I just need an index, so I will never really know what weights to give to these different indicators or what substitution degree between them. Okay? So the 86 is that challenge. Well-being, I don't have a regression. In this case, I can actually run a regression. So the thinking in both cases is the same. I have an index number problem. I have M indicators. I want a scalar. And index numbers, going back to Devizier and Frisch and everyone else, all have different motivations. Mine was from information theory. And I'll share something with you that I've peddled for the last 20, 30 years. When you are in an empirical area, and I think all areas are empirical, you have to do statistics to be scientific. Doing a statistics is quite a commitment. It means that you are blind to every other information that is important other than the distribution of your data. All that you could ever learn as a scientist from your observations, the most you can learn is the distribution of the data. Everything else you do is a function of that distribution. So the ultimate information about the body of data is this joint distribution. Ironically, it's the simplest thing to get. It's all these other functionals that you want to do. What's the relationship between variables? What are those coefficients? What are index numbers and so on? That is challenging. So the idea is that if S is some aggregator of these M indicators for one individual, in what sense is that S the most truthful, faithful to the information content of these M dimensions? And to follow my philosophy that you have to respect the distribution, so I say S should be such that, this index should be such that its distribution, statistical distribution, has to be the closest to the distribution of its components. Right? So if I have income, health, and education, three dimensions, if I want to index it by one number, by one variable, the distribution of that variable must be the closest to the distribution of its components. If it varies from it, I'm throwing away information. And I'm not missing anything because I'm looking at the distribution. I don't have other tricks a division other people propose about getting indices. I'm trying to find the index that throws away the least amount of information. For this to be implementable, I need criteria. What do you mean by two distributions being close rather than two variables being close? Okay? Yeah, a lot of mathematicians here. So what is the distance between two distributions or divergence? There are not a lot of functionals, believe it or not. Entropy is one of the best functionals. You all probably all have heard of Kullback-Leibler. How many have heard of Kullback-Leibler? One, two, three. Ah, so maybe I should say a few more things about that. How many have heard of entropy? That's much better. Okay. So to demystify, entropy is just another function of a distribution. It happens to be an incredibly revealing function of a distribution, like the characteristic function. So there are a lot of entropies. The most famous is minus expected value of the distribution. Minus expected value of this is called the distribution f of x. Minus expected value of log of it, excuse me. Minus expected value of log of that density is the simplest entropy, Shannon's entropy. It happens to be like the characteristic function, one-to-one relationship with the distribution. If I know the entropy, I know the distribution, and vice versa. But it's in a scalar function of the distribution, so it's used to discriminate between distributions. So if I have two distributions, I want to judge the divergence between them. I compute the entropy for both of them, and the difference between them is the relative entropy, the information difference between those two distributions. If you symmetrize it, average it, it's called Kullback-Leibler. Kullback-Leibler is now all over the place. Every econometrician now reports tests based on Kullback-Leibler. It's effectively likelihood ratio test, expected value of the difference of log likelihoods. The trouble is that there isn't a unique entropy. That minus expected value of logarithm of distribution is the simplest entropy. It has a problem. I think I'm the only one who goes around criticizing that aspect of it. So when you look at the Shannon entropy of two distributions and the difference between it, that's only a measure of divergence. It's not a distance. Distanceness, you all know better than I, requires a triangle rule to be satisfied. To think of three distributions, A, B, and C, triangularity rule is important for distanceness. So a lot of measures of divergence are not metric. There's only one that is a metric, and it's Hellinger. It's a translation of Hellinger, but it's an entropy. That's the one I use in a lot of work. Here, what I do is first translate all my indicators into shares. It's very popular to do that in income inequality literature because now you're talking about size distribution of things. In my world, I have to actually do this because how do I otherwise compare health, education, and income to very different units, concepts? But once I make them into shares, they're all between 0 and 1. They're scores. And so they all have the same scale, as it were. It turns out that that's about as good a definition of a probability as there is. These shares are between 0 and 1, non-negative. So I'm really going to pretend like these are distributions. They are. They're size distributions of these m dimensions. So I'm back to being able to use entropic distances to measure the distance between my index, S, and all of its components, M components. Okay? And this is a generalized entropy. For various values of beta, it gives you very well-known entropies like Shannon's relative entropy and so on. And I would like you to focus only on the last summation. The last summation is a beta entropic or generalized entropic distance between my index for individual I and his F indicator, say income. So this is the distance, entropic distance between the index and one of the F indicators. This is the summation of all those distances. Okay. There is no weighting. I'll give it a weight in a moment. But if I solve this, minimize this with respect to Si. So I don't know what functional form Si will have. In fact, truthfully, when I was doing this in 1979, I had no idea what Si would be. I minimized this, and Si ends up being a very well-known function. Let me give you its final form to save time. This is where I weight all these distances to different dimensions by alpha f. I give a certain weight to being away from income distribution. I give another weight to being away from health distribution, from education, and so on. We'll talk about what these alpha f's and betas could come from empirically in a moment. That's an ongoing thing. But this general solution, you're familiar with it, is the Cobb-Douglas or generalized hyperbolic mean. It's an average. It's not surprising. It includes Cobb-Douglas, generalized geometric, and importantly, includes linear for beta equal to minus one. In fact, in other words, Shannon's entropy, special case of this, gives me a linear aggregator. Now you think linear aggregator, who would use that? The answer is everybody. United Nations produces an index of well-being. It's an index, everyone uses it. Everyone is using it as an assessment method to see if a country is doing well in a number of dimensions. But it's a linear average of several dimensions like health, education, and income. The weights are chosen subjectively. So some committee meets, says income should have half weight and health should have one quarter, the other one one quarter, because it's very difficult to decide. For years, I would do this and look at the inferences I wanted to make and report a mapping between my conclusions and the values of alphas and betas to see what was a stable, what was robust. Last 2 years, I've found in a statistical way of sussing out the alphas and betas, actually a few methods. If there is time, I'll share that with you. But please beware that all the known indices that you've ever worked with or you ever read about are special cases of this, including the most dominant. The most dominant is the one I dislike the most, the linear case. When you pick beta, or effectively you have taken beta to be minus one. So let's pose it as a question to the audience. What's wrong with the linear weighted average as an index of things? It's almost in our DNA to average things, right? That's a linear function, weighted sum of these XFs. Who would offer me a criticism? Beautiful. The marginal rate is constant, doesn't depend on the other variables. It gets to the question of substitutability. A linear function backdoor has assumed infinite substitutability between different dimensions. Think about it. One of the indicators is health, the other is income, right? So you find one additional year of schooling infinitely substitutable with income, or one upgrade in your health status is infinitely substitutable with a dollar. And not only that, because it's an index, it's true for everybody. So Steve Jobs, who died from cancer, billions, his willingness to substitute an one point upgrade in health is the same as mine, or someone who may not have income tonight to buy food, right? It's patently false. these dimensions are not infinitely substitutable. So the linear function has that as a huge problem, but it is so simple, it's so familiar, so it's used. Besides, when you have a linear average, like United Nations index, you think you're making very few arbitrary choices, but you've already picked beta to be minus one. You've picked infinite substitution already, but you don't think you made that choice. It's hidden. So I don't like that, and I really don't use it in any of my own work. It's perfectly all right to use this general form and practice or try to discover these betas and alphas. Furthermore, I didn't think I'll dwell on this as much as I have today. You could actually choose different betas and alphas for different subgroups to allow for further heterogeneity. There's no problem in doing that at all. It's just like writing the entropic function for different groups and use the data for those groups. Okay, enough of the index. This had almost no statistics in it, right? I just have a lot of indicators. I'm looking for a mathematically optimal way of combining them. In the functional form situation, if I have observations on an output variable, I run a regression on these Cobb-Douglas functions. We know we can do that with ease and find these alphas and betas. If I don't have an output variable, I have to do something about finding alphas and betas. Very briefly, I promised myself not to do this, but weakness. Now I have a purely database way of solving this. So I'll get the non-parametric joint distribution of my income and health and education. I have the surface of the non-parametric distribution. I project these into quantiles. These quantiles are not points. They're sets, because I have many dimensions. In these quantile sets, I discover the alphas and betas. These are like isoquants. So for every group, I have their own particular alphas and betas, and it's horrifying. The heterogeneity that is so assumed away in every elegant economic theory that you read about is utterly false. Different groups have different alphas, different weights to different dimensions, and they substitute differently. So that's my way of purely statistical way of discovering alphas and betas. The bad news, I can't do it in too many dimensions, because you have to get the non-parametric joint distribution. But it's doable. The second objective I mentioned, so you now want to use big data, multiplicity of variables and observations to determine an output. Forget about the functional form. The dominant paradigm is linear, or apparently linear, because variables can be transformed into any functional they want. So linearity is in terms of parameters. And this is where I've stolen from Victor's webpage. Go to MIT, he has all of his papers and fantastic presentations on everything done on Beamer or whatever he uses. But this is what I couldn't type on text. So you have p variables, and forget about this part, the DI part. The prototypical big data problem these days, you're a Google or you're a forecaster or anyone else, you have all these X's, and your trick, your object, is to find the best fit for YI. It's a prediction problem, okay? And to be fair, linearity is just an example, dominant example, but I could do sub-Einstein parametrics, bring in all kinds of polynomials and so on. That's not an issue. That's a practicality issue rather than an impossibility issue. So without this part, I can use Lasso, I can use all the new techniques of shrinkage and penalization to solve this problem. The fact that P may be a lot larger than N is resolved. Shrinkage, Lasso, and so on can handle that. The question is, what is the statistical property of what I've got? And that's where new asymptotic theory of P larger than N comes in, and it's in pretty good shape, though hard to understand in practice still. The trouble is, if you are more ambitious, like you want to discover the law mechanism that generates this output, the econometrics problem, the economist problem, sociologist problem, right? The physicist problem. Doyne was talking about being very practical about these things to explain where YI comes from, learn the mechanism. It's extremely challenging. Think of this paradigm in the most popular area of research now in econometrics, treatment effect. Program evaluation treatment effect. It's 90% of frontier research in econometrics. When we go to hire people, 9 out of 10 or more of our candidates are doing microeconometrics, meaning this. There are no new techniques. You're still running regressions and doing maximum likelihoods and so on. The problem is, what is the meaning of these things? So let me just very briefly talk about that. If I'm interested in finding this alpha, I'm interested in the impact of some treatment on certain part of a population. I give 300 people aspirins or some medical treatment, or I give them a particular work training program or education, some classes. I want to decide what is the impact of that training on those guys. Used to run a regression and have an alpha hat and report the standard errors and so on, go home. The trouble is, that's wrong. In order for me to claim this alpha measures the impact of treatment on you, I have to observe you not getting that treatment. So observe you without the treatment, observe you with the treatment, so that my claim is correct that that's really the impact, identify the impact of that treatment on you guys. The problem is, I have an entire missing sample, not a missing observation. I'll never observe the counterfactual. I will observe you either treated or not treated. So I have to go out, find your twins. It's called matching. I have to find people who are identical to you, and you have to now ask, what do you mean by identical, right? Back to the prior problem, believe it or not, and it took me a while to realize what matching is, propensity score matching. How many have heard of propensity score matching? It's an indexing problem. So I give everyone a score, a scalar score, based on P indicators. I give everyone, I have to give everyone a score between 0 and 1. You call it the probability of being treated. Mathematically, I'm giving a score between 0 and 1. I'm running a probability logit regression on all these x's. I'm doing the old-fashioned Massoon indexing. I am indexing all these p variables into a number, giving that a score. Now I give the score to people from PSID, or I find some data from Mashhad. I have some people treated in Tehran. I give them those scores, and if those scores are in some sense close, then I see that they didn't get the treatment. You got the treatment, the difference is the treatment effect. Okay, so matching, propensity score matching is an indexing problem. And it's a question of what are the right indices. It's a multidimensional indicator problem. And we have a lot of indicators now. That's good news, because there's an assumption in this field, huge assumption, is that D and Y, the output and treatment, are independent given the X's. Old-fashioned conditioning that is presumed backdoor in all regressions in order for you to claim what you have is really what you have. So conditional independence is really credible if you have a lot of X's, right? In the practical literature, these X's are very few. Big data is now says we have a lot of X's. So it's become a lot more credible. I have 150 variables, there's nothing left to the imagination. So the assumption that D and Y are independent conditionally is a lot more credible. So anyway, this is a big problem. If P is small, it's a traditional regression problem, I just have found a way of interpreting it better. technically I'm not going to do anything other than regression. When P is very large, we all know from our econometrics 101 what happens if you have a lot of x's. You get larger standard errors, right? Say if you run a regression, significance become a problem, right? So the credibility of each one of these coefficients becomes less and less dubious. You know the old Teilman specification analysis. If you omit a variable, you suffer biases. But you always get better variance. Even if you make an error, you have a smaller variance. Dirty little secret of parsimonious models. They're very certain, but they're certain around the wrong coefficient because you have bias. If you have a lot of variables, you don't incur inconsistency bias, but the variance goes large. So if I'm after discovering mechanism, saying what was the role of these X's on this treatment effect, on a variable, target variable of interest, forget about treatment effect, I have a problem when I have a lot of P's. There's no credibility, there's no certainty. Confidence intervals just really increase. If I really don't have an interest in discovering the mechanism, I just want that, then I don't care. I'm not interested in the betas. I'm interested in the collective fit, right? And that's where lasso shrinkage and all the big data new methods shine. They are not interested in finding the betas, they're interested in finding the entirety of that second term. I give you an example. There's a translation of this many moment problem. How do you choose when you have a lot of moment problems, a lot of moment restrictions, as in method of moments, generalized method of moments? How do you select and what's the best procedure to go? In the second part, I give you an example of that. Okay, because I was stealing from Victor, I thought I'd give you a preview of do's and don'ts. He's a colleague of Josh Angrist. Angrist writes these books that tells everybody you're fine, doesn't matter, just go ahead and run a regression. He does the opposite. He says everything you do is very dangerous. I think a little bit more like him than Angrist. So the question is, how would you conduct this regression with so many variables? There is a way to run any regression that is as old as time that comes handy here. How many know about Frisch-Wu regression? Something you already know, you may not know it by that name. So I'm running a regression of a variable y on two sets of variables, x1s and x2s. I can run a brute force multiple regression on all of them, right? There's an alternative, is there not? I run a regression of x1 on x2, clean it up, projection. I get the residuals. I now run the regression of my original dependent variable on these residuals. I get the correct partial effects of x1. It's taking care of the covariation between x1 and x2. There's two ways of doing this. It's purging variables of the influence of other variables. It's very nicely done in linear regression. So whether you run the entire regression or these partial regressions is the same thing. And that's exactly what you would do here, except P is large. And if P is larger than N, it won't work. Your intuition to do something like Frisch-Wu will mislead you. Because in that paradigm, you have the option of cleaning the dependent variable of the influence of x2, get the residuals, clean up x1 from the influence of x2, now run a regression between the residuals. But you don't have to clean y from the influence of x2. That's optional. That's no longer true. So here, you have to do what is called double selection. You have to go through the entire Frisch-Wu thing because you're doing penalization and lasso and everything else. P is too large, you're not running simple regressions, so the two methods are not the same. You will clean up you run regression of DI on all of these XIs, do a lasso selection of the X's and so on, and get the residuals from that. You run a regression of YI on all these XIs, do a lasso variable selection, clean that up, get the residuals. Now run a regression of residuals from YI on the residuals from DI. That's going to give you consistent estimates of alpha. It's the legacy of big data. Big data is not forcing you to do anything fancy, but you have to do it correctly to get consistent estimates. Intuition can mislead, as it were. Okay. A little more sophisticated and old-fashioned about variable selection, model uncertainty. Here, selfishly, I'm going to talk about work that I used to do. It turns out that I was doing ridge regression, Stein-like mixed estimation in my thesis. I was doing it for a very different purpose than we now do them for big data. And it tells you a little bit of a story about connectivity, how slowly we move in science. We keep inventing new names, but take very, very small steps in terms of real progress. The context that was dominant in my time was simultaneous equations, systems of equations, big bank models of the economy. Governments all had two-handed equation models of the economy. They're all linear, like the vector autoregressions again, but they were structural. So I would have a model like this. This may sound unfamiliar to you, sounds very familiar probably to Ali. This is LSC, London School Notation, then Dennis Sargon notation, as it were. So the y's are endogenous variables. There are n equations. 1,210, a lot more than vector autoregression, five variables or three variables. And the z's are exogenous variables. So that's the classification in the x variable. Some are endogenous, some are exogenous. There is a reduced form that connects the y's to the z's. This reduced form, I say selfishly, is everything, because it's your mechanism for forecast. Whatever economic theories you have to describe every equation of this model, whatever restrictions you have, whatever you want to impose, at the end of the day, this is the playground, the reduced form. Because you use it for prediction. If these are the z's, what are the y's, right? It's the input, output. More importantly, that's the medium for policy analysis. If I change some of the instruments, the taxes, what would happen to some of the Y's, consumption, investment, income? So policy analysis is prediction problem. You have to always predict what happens when a particular instrument changes. That's a prediction problem. So we can't get away from prediction problem. The trouble is how to do this, how to statistically determine this reduced form. That was what I wrote my thesis about. And what had just been discovered in an unpublished paper, actually it was never published until I put it in a book of writings of Dennis Sargon. I'm interested in making an impression on you on this issue, because it's important. It explains why the economists and other social scientists don't succeed in forecasting, even if they get the model right. It turns out that if you estimate these structural equations by your favorite methods, two-stage least squares, instrumental variables, three-stage least squares, now we call them GMM, right? It's the same thing, IVs. When you translate those estimators to get your reduced forms, the estimates of P, the reduced form coefficients, have no finite moments. The ratios of B inverse and C, right? P is B inverse times C, So it's a ratio estimator. And there is no way of stopping the measure from going to zero at some point. So the determinant of B at some point passes through the origin, and the moments explode. So if you're a forecaster, what happens to you? You're forecasting Y based on some P hat, some estimator that takes structural information, and your forecast will have infinite variances. There's no certainty with forecast. This is for a correctly specified model. There's no assumption of misspecification. So if you were so lucky to find the model correctly, you would still do badly in forecasting. Of course, in real life, it's mixed up with misspecification as well. Okay? The only estimator that will not have this problem is never used. It's a full system maximum likelihood to this system because it imposes B not being singular. But nobody ever uses it. It's not practical to use it. So my purpose was to still use some of the structural information, but come up with forecasts or estimators that had finite sample moments, had better tail properties, could produce better decisions, as it were. And I had a number of solutions. I'll talk about just a couple of them. Are you all familiar with simultaneous equations? No? Yes? How many are familiar with? Your mind is already. think of a two equation, supply and demand, quantity and price, right? The y's are quantities and prices, two variables. The z's are variables that explain supply and demand, two or three of them. And it's a bunch of technical assumptions, and I have the reduced form, and it has the problem that I mentioned to you. The question is, what does a good econometrician do in practice? A good econometrician in practice goes ahead and tries to test the economic theories and restrictions that we had in the structure. This is a rather obscure way of writing a wall test. You've all seen it in different jargon. This is a system way of writing it. This is testing all of the restrictions on all of the coefficients simultaneously. Don't worry about it. It's a quadratic form that increases in size the further you are from the restrictions you used. The more violation of the economic theories by data, the larger this chi-squared value will be, so the more likely that you will reject the underlying economic theories, right? So the point is that this could be written in another way. That same test statistic can be translated in this way. This is just mathematical transformation. But now I have the things I want in there. I have p hat is running an OLS regression on the reduced forms. No economic theory. It's vector autoregressions. I have y's and z's. I run a regression. By the way, there's no problem. I can have every equation of the model, every theory you ever heard of be wrong. I can have a perfectly good reduced form estimator if I don't use those theories. Just running a regression of y on z. Why don't we do it? Huge variances. OLS is very inefficient, but it's consistent and is well-behaved, has a finite sample distribution. Everything is nice about it. So that's my pivot. I don't want to get too far from p hat, because that's the thing that is sure-footed. That's the pillar. Even if most of my equations are misspecified, this p hat is consistent. P dagger is the derived reduced form estimator. So I estimate every structural equation, gets my B's and C's, translate them to getting p dagger. That's the one that is dubious if my underlying theorems are incorrect, if I have misspecification. When you test your model before you report, what do you think happens? You don't report a model that is rejected, right? you test for a reason. If you pass the test, you say, this is what I found, and it's fine. What does that mean? It means that anytime you report a model, this wall test is less than a significance level, right? Your favorite, 95%, 90%, whatever. Which means this wall, the statistic, is less than a constant. And what I did, well, first, I proposed this estimator. It's a shrinkage estimator. I'll show you why it's a Stein-like estimator. It has a lot of new names now. Could call it lasso, it could call it a lot of other things. But it's a mixture of the restricted estimator that is dubious and the p-hat that is unrestricted estimator that is inefficient but reliable. And what I showed is that if you put p-star in here instead of p-dagger, this statistic would still stay less than a constant, the critical level of the test. And then realization is this. These quadratic forms are ellipsoids. They're little melons in three dimensions. If this melon size is always less than a constant, everything within it will have to have finite moments. And so my mixed estimator, even though it's mixing something that has infinite moments with a p-hat, it still has finite moments. The reason is that lambda is not fixed. Otherwise, that would be impossible. Lambda is picked in order to not to violate the non-rejection of the model, okay, some significance level. And these estimators perform beautifully. I never was able to convince the rest of the profession to use them because I guess I don't explain it well. But they just do fantastically. It's obvious they would do well because you're competing with something that has infinite moments. If your tails of these distributions are massive, whereas the mixed estimator has well-behaved tails and will give you better forecasts. So now, this is about the mechanism of picking lambda to make sure that I get finite sample moments. So let me not dwell too much on this, but connect it to what is happening to model averaging and mixed estimation that is now a big part of big data. So in the paradigm I put up with a lot of variables, you have a problem. You have to run a lot of tests, t-tests and f-tests and so on, or more sophisticated tests to decide which variables are significant. It's the simplest version of model selection, model uncertainty. It's called variable selection. You're skipping functional form issues, statistical issues, you're just saying which variables. That's the simplest example of model uncertainty. And the same test that I'm putting up will have to be done over there. So mixture estimators, shrinkage estimators, are reported to do well with big data for a reason. You have the reason in front of you, sort of an obscurely known reason for it. They have finite sample moments, even if they're mixing horrible other estimators. You're actually reducing the uncertainty by the averaging between different models. This has a Bayesian interpretation, which, again, chapter of my thesis does. Instead of looking at it as a Stein-like estimator or mixture estimator, I can talk about putting priors on the coefficients of my model and do a full Bayes process. And the mode or the median of the prior or the posterior distribution has this mixture form. So in fact, it can be interpreted as a Bayesian way of incorporating model uncertainty. And that's kind of what Victor, I think, will talk about when he talks about those variable selection. That's really what's going on when you model average, and when you mix, when you do lasso, when you penalize. You're doing things that have perfectly good Bayesian interpretations. My point being that these solutions are Bayes solutions. So how many have done Bayesian econometrics? Bayes decisions are optimal by construction. You can't beat them at their own game. Their own game is mean squared error. It's a Gaussian world. So it's a fix. It's a game. People express surprise at mixing forecast as well. You're actually making sure they do well. It's massive amounts of prior information that are being used. We'll see with Lasso. Lasso is a penalization of the coefficients of these variables. You're forcing them to go through zero. That's a lot of prior information. It's Bayesian subjective information. That's an interpretation. You don't have to accept that interpretation. I'm not a Bayesian. But that interpretation is very elegant. It can tell you why, in fact, mixture estimators and model averaging is by design going to do better. It's not an accident that it will do better. Are there any questions? All right. The alternative to this mixture and the pre-tested way of combining estimators, that this is a pre-test estimator. So pre-testing, as bad as it is, actually can be good for you. When you test the model and you report results reflecting the results of those tests, outcome of those tests, your estimators become Bayes estimators. Mixture estimators do better. It's very difficult to establish their distribution. They become very complicated animals. Ali knows David Hendry. David runs thousands of regressions with thousands of tests. And each part of that decision about what to do depends on what happened in the prior set of testing. That's one heck of a random variable at the end of the day. It's quite a combination of mixtures of thousands of tests. We have no idea what it is statistically. This is just one test. It's already difficult to get to the exact distribution of the mixture estimator, but at least I know it has good finite sample properties, it has finite moments. Alternative, very quickly, is this guy. So remember, B times P plus C has to be zero for P to be the reduced form of this model. Now that would be fine if you believed all my economic theories that impose restrictions on Bs and Cs. So I have a paper called Generic Reduced Form Models, in which I play scenarios of misspecification. So your equations are in logs or some other nonlinearity, and you estimate linear, or you're missing variables, you include variables that you shouldn't. In all of those, I show that B times P plus C is no longer zero. It's something else, something non-zero. Depending on what kind of misspecification, D is different. And in reality, you don't know which misspecifications. Probably all of them are being committed. So this D thing is very complex. A practical approach to it is to say, I don't know anything about it. I just know that I can't say zero with probability one. And all of econometrics does that. It's one way of looking at it. All of econometrics assumes D is equal to zero with probability one. The one thing we know in econometrics is that that is not true. So how to proceed with that is the only way formally, scientifically, we represent ignorance. You put a distribution on D. So putting a distribution on D is a backdoor way of putting a distribution like a DSGE guy does with vector autoregressions, these Bayesian priors on 250 coefficients. That's not happening here. This is a model search, Ed Lehmer kind of search for uncertainty. I put a distribution on D, say normal, as zero mean, and it's possible for it not to be zero with different probabilities. And then I act, you could call me a Bayesian, I get the joint likelihood of the data and this D. It's the likelihood plus prior, or from my point of view, there's no such thing as prior. It's just the distribution of the parameters, or these Ds. It's a perfectly good way of representing uncertainty. We are happy to put distributions on the data. We don't know where they come from. But somehow people are reluctant to put distributions on parameters. What I see is a joint likelihood of the data and the parameters, and I go ahead and do likelihood estimation. If you do that, remarkably, the joint likelihood estimators will end up having this kind of shape. They become mixture estimators as well. Exactly that. You have some leeway in terms of what p-dagger to use. In that setup, the p-dagger would be maximum likelihood estimator, the regular without the uncertainty. So these mixture estimators that are being used with modern big data techniques really have quite attractive interpretations and properties. They're okay to use, as it were. But it's good to know what it is that they represent. If you like, then I will stop here and come back and give this very formal description of how to choose a subset of the moments when you have many moment conditions. That's the version of many variables shaping itself into many orthogonality conditions, as it were. And having selected among those moments, how do different estimation methods combine? What is the best way of model selection and then post-selection estimation? It's a simulation exercise. I think it's very reachable, and we have some fairly good conclusions about what kinds of methods are likely to work in practice. So I'll do that and maybe do a little bit on models as latent objects, if there is time.
ببین میخوام بگم که شما دارید میگید که در واقع این درسته، میخوام دابل چک کنم. میخوام بگم که شما دارید میگید که به جای اینکه دنبال این باشیم که بعد از اینکه یک مدلی فیت کردیم و گودنس آف فیت ایندایسز و اینا همه اوکی شدن، چه ابسولوت چه ریلیتیو، بعد حالا نمیدونم شاید در اشتباه بود، بعد از این نیاییم بگیم که فلان وریبل رو اینجوری پردیکت بکنیم، به جای این بگیم که یک سیستم دیگه ای رو، یعنی این سیستم داره ایوولو میشه به یه سیستم دیگه ای، ممکنه معادلاتش عوض بشه حتی، و اون رو داریم در واقع پردیکت میکنیم. به جای اینکه یک وریبل پردیکت بکنیم، یک اکوسیستم در واقع پردیکت میکنیم، یه اسنپشات بعدی سیستم رو داریم پردیکت میکنیم. میشه اینجوری گفت؟
Yes and no. So من میگم هدف رو باید مشخص کرد. یه هدف اینه که شما میخواید درست پردیکت کنید. مثلا شما یه تریدر هستید. کوانت دیپارتمنت یه فینانس فرم هستید. فقط میخواید الگوریتمتون پول بساز. من میام وضع هوا رو در هندوستان هم وریبلش رو میذارم اون تو. Somehow it improves my performance in the market. It's a black box. All I care about is getting it right, getting the fit right. شما نمیخواید کلیم کنید که کلایمت توی ویلز بود که کمک کرد به پردیکشنتون، یا اینکه rate of interest بود یا macro variable بودن. You've given up on mechanism discovery. عرضی که خدمت کردم اینه که اون هر چقدر هم که سختی آسان ترین هدفه. هدفی که بخواید کشف کنید reproducible laws، مکانیزم رو کشف کنید، is almost impossible تو بعضی رشته ها، مثلا macro social outcomes. اینقدر این مکانیزم سخت خواهد بود، اینقدر چیزهای غیر اقتصادی توش خواهد بود که claiming که آدم بتونه کشفش بکنه. میخواید کشفش کنید برای اینکه ساینتیست میخواید باشید، میخواید این ترانسپورتبل باشه، چیزی که دیسکاور کردید در زمانهای دیگه، مکانهای دیگه قابل استفاده باشه. جنرالایزبیلیتی که صحبت کردیم دیروز یه خورده دوین که پرزنت میکرد، اون خیلی سخت داری. بعضی میگن غیر از این که مکانیزمو کشف بکنی کاری دیگه نباید بکنی، چون که اکشنبل نیست. شما وقتی پالیسی میکر هستی تو مکانیزمو ندونی فایده نداره. درسته میخواید بگی من این کارو بکنم، اون میشه، اون میشه، اون میشه. وقتی مکانیزمو نمیدونید فایده نداره. The policy making is in trouble. Is winging it. Is not scientific. احتیاج داره به کشف کردن مکانیزم. دیتاهای زیادتر ما فکر نمیکنم به این موضوع کمک کنه. مسیج منفی اینه که دیتاهای زیادتر و وریبل‌های زیادتر فیتو بهتر میکنه مکانیزم دیسکاوری رو. I just don't see how that can solve. باید با مدل انسرتنتی زندگی کرد. این پیپری که جی آر اف میگه is how to live with specification if you must to advertise it, the bunch of papers in Journal of Econometrics. وقتی تمام مدل‌ها میسپسیفایدن what do you do with that. دوتورایی که براتون گفتم are struggles to deal with that. نمیخواید ابندون کنید تئوری رو، مدل دیسکاوری رو، ولی در این حال میدونید غلطه. So these two last techniques I talked about, model averaging, shrinkage, اینا تمام interpretationشون اینه که is a way of living with the fact that you can't ever discover the data generation process. پیپر آخری که صحبت میکنم شاید 10-15 دقیقه is also about that. پس هدف خیلی مهمه. جاهایی که میتونید با fit و prediction actionable باشید، decision های خوب بگیرید، منفعت کنید، fine. جاهایی که میخواید replicable باشه و قابل بحث باشه که چیکارا میشه کرد و تأثیراش چیه is I just don't see it necessarily benefiting. من با 35 سال 40 سال با انتروپی زندگی کردم. وقتی انتروپی دنیا بالاتر میره کمتر راجعش میفهمید. The first thing that increases entropy is dimension. The more variables you have, the less certain the world is. Impart kardanish khali sakhte. It's counterintuitive almost. The more you know, you think. It's because it's not that you're not knowing the more, it's just quantitatively more, you're not learning more.
We speak about entropy, this is the uncertainty of system. And you see, if we know about system more, then the entropy is?
So entropy is a measure of uncertainty of a distribution. So if something is known with probability one, degenerate distribution, its entropy is zero. The flatter it becomes, all the states of the world become equally likely and you get maximum entropy. Mm-hmm. It's a very simple measure of flatness of a distribution. Entropy is a fancy word, something very simple. It turns out that within the context of given set of dimensions, you have a minimum and maximum entropy. Once I go above the dimensions I have, it's a new world. The entropy of a three-dimensional distribution is always larger than its two-dimensional components. So dimensionality increases uncertainty, increases entropy, rather than decreasing it.
سوال من خیلی خلاصتر و کلی‌تر از این دو تا سوالی که پرسیده شد. شما ابتدای صحبتتون گفتید که داشتید در مورد اپلیکیشن‌های بیگ دیتا صحبت می‌کردید. گفتید سه تا دایرکشن هست یا سه تا وجه هست. توی کانتکست اکونومیکس گفتی که بیگ دیتا استفاده میشه برای ایندکس کردن و ایندکسینگ، یعنی گیوینگ اسکور فور ان ایندیویدوال. بعدش گفتید که برای پیدا کردن امپریکال اکونومیک لوز. من دایرکشن سومش متوجه نشدم.
پردیکت بلک باکس پردیکشن.
بلک باکس
یعنی دو تا به نظر شبیه میان، هر دو تا شده مثلا ریگرشن ران میکنی. اون پارادایمی گذاشتم از پیجای ویکتور اون بود. یکیش علاقه دارید تأثیر یه تارگت وریبل رو که اسمشو دی گذاشته بودیم پیدا کنید، اون مکانیزم لازم داری. یکیش هستش هیچ علاقه‌ای به این که تأثیرهای مختلف وریبل‌های مختلف چیه ندارید، فقط میخواید گود فیت داشته باشید. هر دوش تکنیکا به نظر میاد یکیه، ولی هدف‌های مختلف باعث موفقیت و غیر موفقیت میشه.
اون قابلیت تفسیر داشته باشن و بتونیم تاثیرشون رو پیدا کنیم، این بسی که وجود داره. همونطور که خودتون گفتین خیلی وقتا معادلات لینیر استفاده میکنن برای اینکه قابلیت تفسیر پذیری داره، و حالا بعضی جاها برای اینکه حل معادلات بین سازی راحت‌تر بشه. میخواستم ازتون بپرسم که توی روش‌های مثل لاسو و شرینکج که ما میتونیم تعداد وریبل رو خیلی زیاد داشته باشیم و به نوعی سلکت کنیم، وریبل سلکشن داشته باشیم توی تخمین حالا مثلا تارگت وریبلمون، تو مواردی که کار کردین استفاده از فیچرهای دیگه که مشتق شده از همین فیچرها، مثلا اگر x1 تا xn دارم لاگ همین ها رو بذارم توی اینپوت وکتور، و با توجه به اینکه میگم الان توان کامپیوتیشنال به قول شما خیلی بالا رفته، ما میتونیم خیلی تعداد خیلی زیادی از مشتقات فیچرهای اولیه‌مون رو بذاریم و به نوعی نان لینیریتی رو اینجوری هندل کنیم. این روش رو مفید میدونین یا نه؟
سوال خیلی مهمیه. بعضی لینیریتی ها ظاهرن. دو تا لینیریتی داریم. یه لینیریتی در وریبل هاست، یه لینیریتی در پارامتر هاست. نکته مهمی که شما میگید اینه که این اکسایی که دیدید میتونن خیلی فانکشن های فنسیه دیتا باشن، پولینومیوز، ارثاگونال پولینومیز. الان فیلد سمای نان پارامتریکس تروز ریلی ماسیو ارثاگونال پولینومیوز. اون کاری که میکنید دو مرتبه دارید نان لینیاریتی اکسا رو میارید، ولی کوفیشنت ها اکثرا هنوز فیکست هستن، بهتر از لینیر اکسا هستن، خیلی بهترن، ولی دارید یه استریت جکتی رو خودتون میذارید. مثال میزنم، یک وریبل وای هست، میخواد تاثیر اکس روش بگیرید، اکس اسکوئرد هم میذارید. خب پس یه مقدار دیگه لینیر نیست، ولی تاثیر اکس شد لینیر، میشه تاثیر خطی به علاوه چی میگفتیم، مشتق میگفتیم، اکس اسکوئرد وقتی 2x right. پس فرم تأثیر اکس به اکس ربط داره، ولی یه فرم خاصی داره. این پولینومیال ها رو که سمای نان پارامتریک میذارن از این محدودیت ها جدا میشه، فقط you give up something. We have no idea what the influence of each x is. خیلی تأثیر خیلی complicated پیدا میکنن. پس اون نان لینیاریتی تو اکس کاملا درست میگید. فکر کنم ویکتور will treat this. You can get very fancy in terms of what functionals of x you put in. اگر که صحبت با علی جون چند روز پیش میکردیم، آقای حبیب نیا، لینیاریتی خیلی چیز شدیدتر از اونیست که به نظر میرسه. شما فکر کنید مینسر اکویژن آرلی ویجز ریگرس دارید میکنید روی سالهای ایژوکیشن، نمبر آف ایرز آف سکولی، خب به علاوه ایج و اکسپیرینس این حرف رو ببینید. لینیاریتی معنیش چیه؟ میگه که تعداد سالهای درس خوندنتون یه کوفیشنت فیکس داره، یعنی از کودکستان که به سال اول میرید همونقدر منفعت میکنید که از فوق لیسانس به پی اچ دی. این یه برنامه اشکال لینیاریتی توی پارامتر که اشکاله. بزرگترین اشکال لینیاریتی سپرابیلیتیه. میگه ایژوکیشن و نمیدونم شغل پدر و محلی که هستید و اکسپیرینس تاثیراشون سوان هستن، خیلی مهمتره و خیلی چیز بدیه. اکثر اوقات کوفیشنت یه وریبل فانکشن وریبل های دیگه است، یعنی کسی که هستید تاثیر میذاره که چه استفاده از ایژوکیشن میکنید. پس این کوفیشنت x1 is a function of x2 and x3. من خیلی نان پارامتریک دوست دارم تا اونجا که میتونی، برای که نان پارامتریک ریگرشن همه تأثیرها فانکشن همه وریبل های دیگه هم هستن. So linearity is a bigger problem than meets the eye. فقط خطی بودن در X نیست، خطی بودن در بیتاست و separability.
پس پس اگریگیشن ایندکسینگ رو مثلا متوجه شدم آخرش
لطفا بلندتر بگید.
اگریگیشن ایندکسینگی که فرمودین من متوجه نشدم مثلا چجوری ما نهایتا ایندکس کردیم، یعنی شما
چجوری ایندکس کردم؟ فلسفهش این بود که هر نوع مشخص عمومی ایندکس یه مقدار معلومات از چیزایی که داخلش میره برمیداره، اینفورمیشن‌های مختلف، right؟ هر کاریش بکنید یه فانکشنی که از یک مش وریبل دارید داری یه استفاده های خاصی میکنید از اینفورمیشنی که توی دیستریبیوشن کامپوننتاش هستش. اگر بخواید ایندکستون بهترین معرف چیزایی که داخلش هستن باشن، پس دیستریبیوشنش، التیمیت اینفورمیشنش پس نزدیکتر بشه به دیستریبیوشن کامپوننتاش. اونجا بود که انتروپی رو استفاده کردیم. انتروپی فاصله بین دیستریبیوشن ایندکس و کامپوننتاش بود، اونو مینیمایز کردیم، تفاوت دیستریبیوشن ها رو مینیمایز کردیم، فانکشنال فرم ایندکس بیرون اومد. که
ایندکس یه موضوعی از یه سری فاکتور،
ایندکس ساموریه، معرف اوریج این کامپوننت های توش،
میانگین موضوع یه سری فاکتور. اون ایندکس حالا آنتروپیش فرمودین که مینیمایز کردین جوری که
ایندکس دیدید که هایپربولیک اوریج دیتا است، همه ایندکس ها اوریج هست. ریگرشن از اوریجینگ، I don't know whether you realize that or not. هر موقع ریگرس دارید ران میکنید یور اوریجینگ. In fact, there is a bunch of papers coming out in Annals of Maths and Stats that talks about model averaging as indexing, as aggregation. You're always aggregating information and data to say something in one direction or other. اگه اجازه بدید یه چیزی میخوام راجع به ایندکس بگم. معلوماتی که تو دیتای شما هست یه قسمتی اکویژنی، معلوماتی که ایندکستون میتونه درک بکنه یه چیز دیگه است. مثالی که من میزنم سر کلاس همیشه اینه. شما فکر کنید یه لینیر ریگرشن ران کنید. اکساتون میتونه خیلی فنسی باشن. یکیشون گاما دیستریبیوشن داشته باشه، یکیشون بیتا دیستریبیوشن داشته باشه، یه نرمال باشه. خب این دیستریبیوشن ها اینفورمیشن های خیلی مختلفی دارن. شما وقتی ریگرس میکنید ریگرشن رو میدونید چی فقط به چی نگاه میکنید؟
رزیجوال.
It's just a covariance game. It's an analysis of variance. تنها information criteria که regression میتونه استفاده کنه is the covariance. یعنی چی؟ یعنی میگه تمام دنیا نرماله. Everything in the world is normal. برای normal distribution, entropy is the variance. Entropy and normal distribution is variance. The entire world is fixated on variance. یعنی اصلا مهم نیست information تو این تمام variable شما چی. وقتی regression run میکنید all that it cares about is the covariance. پس ایندکسی که دارید استفاده میکنید ابیلیتیش برای استفاده کردن اینفورمیشن خیلی خودش مهمه. فقط اینفورمیشن که دیتاتون هست نیست. اینجاست که من انتروپی رو دوست دارم. برای که by construction is using as much information as there is, it's kind of non-parametric. I didn't say what S should be. I have never assumed what the distribution of X, F should be. We don't care. They can be whatever they are. خیلی non-parametric in a way. Parametric form میگیرید و کارتون non-parametric.
بسیار سپاسگزاریم از پروفسور معصومی. اگه دوستان خسته نباشید من میخواستم جسارت بکنم یکی دو دقیقه راجع به سوالی که دوستمون پرسیدن که بیایم که مثلا حالا توان دو یا سه متغیر رو بذاریم یه خلاصه بگم. ببینید در استاتستیکال مدلایی که سعی میکنه های دایمنشنالیتی رو هندل بکنه ما تقریبا سه تا دسته مدل داریم. یه دسته از مدل ها سعی میکنن که حالا بیان رو بسای همین لیتنت وریبل و اوریجینگ و میان بسای حالا فاکتور انالیزز و بسای پرینسیپل کامپوننت انالیزز هستش. اکس رو گذاشتن، ولی خب در اصل نان لینیارتی توی وریبل مونده نه توی چیز، ولی باز تونستن نشون بدن که چیزی که اکسپلین میکنیم نسبت به اینی که اونا رو نذاریم تو ماکرو اکونومیک پرابلما خیلی بیشتر بوده. توی حالا من خودم شخصا رو بحث اینه که ما در اصل اون فانکشنال فرممون و یا پارامترامون نان لینیار باشه در اصل اومدم یه اکستنشن نان لینیار اضافه کردم، ولی به اون رفرنس نمیدم. توی بحث شرینکج مدل ها، حالا لاسو الاستیک نت یا ریج رگرشن، بحثی که بوده اینه که ما پنالایز کردیم مثلا لاس فانکشنمون رو. اونجا چیزایی که من دیدم که حالا مثلا اومده یکم نان لینیارتی کار کرده، الان مثلا بحث کرنل ریج رگرشن هستش، یا بحثایی که حالا سعی کرده نان لینیاریتی رو به این شکل وارد بکنه که یه ذره متفاوت با این هستش که ما بخوایم وریبل ها رو بخوایم نان لینیار بذاریم. با یک نان لینیار فانکشنی ما دیتا رو مپ میکنیم توی یه فضای جدیدی، در اون فضای جدید که یک ترانسفورمیشن نان لینیار انجام شده، همون ایده‌ای لینیار در اس ریج رو استفاده میکنیم. اینا چند تا رفرنس بود. توی میگم اپروچ‌های مختلفی وجود داره که ما بتونیم نان لینیاریتی رو به این استاتستیکال مدلایی که لینیر هستن و های دایمنشنالیتی رو میخوان کپچر بکنن اضافه بکنیم. من دو تا مثال خواستم فقط خیلی سریع بزنم که یک بحث کرنل هستش که ما مپ بکنیم رو همون فضای مپ شده بیایم لینیر اپروچ رو استفاده بکنیم. یک همین که حالا مثلا تو همین بحث‌ها کار شده که مثلا توانای بالا پولینومیال در اصل اضافه میکنن که جوابش خوب بوده. خیلی گذشته ولی بفهم اگه
اشکالی که وجود داره توی کرنلایزد ورژن ها، کرنلایزد مدل ها، هر روشی که کرنلایزد انجام میشه، همون بحثی که دکتر گفتن، بس اینکه ما هدفمون اینه که فقط تارگت وریبل رو پردیکت بکنیم یا میخوایم اینترپرت هم بکنیم کوفیشنت هامونو. من اون حرفی که زدم فقط یه مشتقاتی از فیچرامون رو بذاریم، اون یه درجه نان لینیاریتی رو توی متغیرها هندل میکنه ولی توی کوفیشنت ها هنوز هندل نمیکنه. ولی مثلا اگر قرار باشد من از کرنل استفاده کنم و نگاشت کنم به فضای جدید مسئله ما دیگه، اون قابلیت تفسیر رو از دست میدم، درسته؟ از دست میدم و میگم ببخشید، میگم که اگر بخوام این کار رو کنم، اون وقت مزیت این روش مثلا نسبت به یک شبکه عصبی چیه که دیگه قابلیت تفسیر رو نداره؟ کل مزیت رگرشن و لینیر رگرشن به اون قابلیت تفسیرش. این کرنل
سیاه‌سفید نیست. شما فکر کنید 15 تا وریبل دارید، ایده‌ای که یه کرنل ریگرشن نان پارامتریک بزنید is a dream. You can't really do that. صحبتی که حبیب نیا جان میکنه اینه که by paying some price in terms of degrees of separability، یه مقدار فانکشنال لیمیتیشن دارید میذارید، then within categories you can do kernels. So you buy freedom of non-linearity و دیتا تصمیم میگیره. اون اجازه میده که دایمنشن های بیشتری رو خلاصه کنید، صحبت کنید. صحبت که میکنید تا یه اندازه درسته، تا یه اندازه ممکن منفی باشه. شما وقتی کرنل نان پارامتریک ران میکنید هنوز دریویتیو رو میتونید بگیرید، تغییر دیپندنت وریبل دریویتیوش به تغییر اکس، اونو میتونید استیمیت کنید و فانکشن همه چیزاست. نمیتونید بنویسیدش چیه، کلوز فرم نداره، ولی یو کن فایند ایت. ایز ا بیگ 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 تاپیک این نان پارامتریکس. سو دوز دریویتیوز هاف ا تاف اینترپریتیشن، دیر ایز ا لیتریچر اون دات. ولی یه اوریج افکت variable interestتون هست رو why، ولی نمیتونید بنویسیدش چیه، numerically پیداش میکنید با کامپیوتر، ولی نمیتونید یه functional form برش دیگه بنویسید.
خوزم مشکل.